A river is a natural stream of flowing water. It is the force of gravity that pulls a river downwards to its final destination, the oceans. In some cases, rivers may end up in lakes or in marshes. Rivers are found on every continent, on every kind of landform, where they wind their way through mountain valleys, forests, canyons, and gorges. Rivers also move across deserts, grasslands, and plains. A river may be fairly short, or it may span almost an entire continent, like the River Nile in Africa, the longest river in the world, with a length of over 6,500 kilometers. The majority of the rivers of our planet finally empty out into the oceans. Every second, billions of cubic meters of water are discharged into the oceans by the rivers of our planet. And in doing so, the rivers carry out one of the most vital functions in the makeup of our planet. They ensure the endless movement of water between the land, the oceans, and the atmosphere. Let us see how this comes about. The Earth is known as the water planet. 70% of its surface is submerged under the oceans, which contain 97% of all the water on our planet. Of the balance, over 2% is frozen in ice sheets and glaciers. Less than 1% is in the streams, lakes, and the ground. A tiny fraction, less than 1/1000th of a percent, is in the atmosphere, and it is this tiny amount that serves as the key to the hydrological channel between the ocean and the land. The seawater constantly evaporates due to the heat of the sun. From the resulting water vapors, clouds form and carry the moisture over land to release it later as precipitation. This movement of water between land, the oceans, and the air is called the water cycle. And it is through this water cycle that the Earth's supply of fresh water, essential for living things, is replenished. Rainfall and other forms of precipitation like snow, hail, fog, and mist provide directly or indirectly all the water which is guided into channels to form streams and rivers. Even though all the water contained in the rivers of the world is a mere 1/1000th of 1%, rivers are by far the most potent agents of degradation of our planet. River water is a powerful agent of degradation, creating fantastic land sculptures, carving out deep gorges, valleys, and broad plains. Its energy constantly alters and creates the surface features of the Earth. The weathered remains of the mountains are swept along by the rivers in the form of more than 10 billion tons of sediment each year. Of this, nearly half is discharged by six rivers alone. They are Huanghe, Yangtze, now called Changjiang, the Irrawaddy, the Mekong, the Indus, and the Brahmaputra. All of these rivers originate on the rooftop of the world and in the icy wastes of the Himalayas. In the high Himalayas, where the monsoon rainfall is heavy, huge boulders come tumbling down the steep slopes. Each year, thousands of tons of material is stripped from each square kilometer. River erosion is the cumulative effect of many processes, like the solvent and chemical activity of river water on the material with which it comes in contact. Another is the hydraulic action, or the force of water flow which removes the bed and bank material. Once armed with loosened debris, running water becomes very destructive. If you see a river calmly flowing downstream, it is hard to believe that it could possibly have carried the huge boulders and debris strewn around its banks. But to see the same river in flood is to see another mood. As it ranges onwards, it pushes and bounces large boulders, which will be deposited in the lower reaches. In fact, if the velocity of a river is doubled, its transporting power is increased tenfold. The Himalayan rivers, in fact, are among the most violently erosive rivers of the planet. The material is broken down by the river as it is transported further downstream. It forms a variety of shapes and sizes. It breaks down further because of the constant battering of the rocks against each other. This process is called attrition. The load of a river is transported in four different ways: by traction, where the load is rolled along the stream; by saltation, where the particles are moved in a series of short jumps; and by being held in suspension or in solution dissolved in water. Through sustained river action, the rocks carried by the river are ground to fine silt and sand. They are deposited in the lower reaches of the river and finally in the oceans to begin life as sedimentary deposits. The beginning of a river is called its source. This source may be ice melting from a glacier, or snow melting on a mountain top, or perhaps a spring bubbling out of the ground, or from a lake. It may also be the result of direct runoff from rainfall. The uplands from which rivers originate form the catchment area. The crests of the mountains are called the water divide or the watershed. From here, these streams flow down both sides and thus begin their journey to the oceans. Streams and rivers, whose original course is determined by the initial slope of the land, are called consequent streams, because their flow is a consequence of the predetermined slopes of the land. The tributaries that join this main stream are called insequent or lateral consequent rivers. As a river flows downstream along its course, it is fed by other streams and rivers. These are called its tributaries. A river, together with its tributaries, is known as a river system, or is said to form a drainage pattern. The final pattern of drainage which emerges depends on the nature and structure of the rocks over which the consequent stream flows. If the rocks are uniformly resistant, the drainage pattern which forms is like a tree in appearance. This is called a dendritic pattern. In nature, however, both hard and soft rocks occur. Where the rock is hard, narrow valleys are carved, and wide valleys are formed over soft rock. A typical drainage pattern developed in an area of mixed rocks is known as a trellised drainage pattern, where the tributaries of a consequent river flow at right angle to the main river. When drainage channels radiate in all directions from a central area, a radial or a concentric drainage pattern develops. This kind of drainage is usually found on the slopes of volcanoes or on the slopes of conical hills. Another unique drainage pattern is the centripetal drainage. In this drainage form, the streams flow towards a central depression. This type of drainage exists in the Kathmandu Valley on the Bagmati River. A river is often described as passing through successive stages of development from youth to maturity to old age. In the upper or mountain course, the river is in its stage of youth. It has the most erosive energy as the slopes here are very steep. Here it rages down the steep slopes. Predominant action of the river here is vertical corrosion. The valley that develops is deep and V-shaped. In those cases where the rocks are very resistant, deep gorges are formed. The Indus, the Ganga, and the Brahmaputra are good examples of this action. In arid regions where there is little rainfall, the rivers cut deep into the valley floor. The Grand Canyon in America and the deep canyons in the Spiti Valley in the arid Himalayan desert are classic examples of this formation. Rapids and cataracts are also prominent physical features in the youthful stage of the river. Where the water tumbles over boulders and ledges, rapids are formed. Waterfalls are a much larger version of cataracts. An outstanding feature in the upper reaches is river piracy. In this case, a stream may do so much headward erosion that it eventually cuts into another stream. Water from the captured stream then starts to flow into the pirate river. In the middle course, vertical corrosion is replaced by lateral corrosion. Thus, U-shaped valleys are a common occurrence. An important feature of this stage is the formation of meanders. These are formed when the river follows the natural gradient of the land and forms semicircular bends with smooth curves. Another feature of the mature valley is braiding. This occurs when a river laden with sediment emerges from a ravine onto a bordering plain. Because the velocity of the river is suddenly checked by the abrupt change in the gradient, much of its sediment load is dropped. The volume of this debris obstructs the river's flow. To overcome the obstacle, the river divides into distributaries which continually separate and unite. In the lower course, the river flows through a very level plain on its way to the sea. It has a large volume of water and carries a great amount of finely ground load. River's erosive action is still going on, but at this stage, a large amount of deposition occurs. The mineral-rich alluvium deposited by the river makes the floodplains very fertile. In fact, the floodplains of the Indus, Ganges, and the Brahmaputra rivers are among the most highly productive agriculture regions of the planet. When the river deposits most of its load along the banks, it raises them and forms embankments or levees. These levees are the highest part of the floodplain and run parallel to the river. Sometimes when there is heavy flooding in the river, these levees may be breached, causing devastating floods. This is a common occurrence in the Himalayan rivers. The river Brahmaputra is specially notorious. When many youthful rivers with their heavy loads descend from the mountains to the plains, they drop their suspended loads and form structures called alluvial fans. When these fans have steep sides, they are called alluvial cones. In some instances, when closely placed rivers discharge from mountainous regions, their deposits may eventually unite to form a continuous plain. This plain is called a Piedmont alluvial plain. An excellent example is the Indo-Gangetic Plain in India, which extends from the delta of the Indus to that of the Ganges and Brahmaputra rivers. An interesting feature of the lower course of the river is the Oxbow Lake, which is a semicircular lake formed by the cutting away of a part of a meander in the river. Most of the sediment load of a river is eventually carried out to the sea or a lake. As the stream enters these water bodies, its velocity is checked, and if the rate of deposition is greater than the removal of the material to the sea or lake, the river deposits its sediment at the mouth to form a fan-shaped deposit called a delta. An arcuate or fan-shaped delta is the most common. The Nile and the Ganges are examples of this kind of delta. A bird's foot delta may also develop when many channels branch off from the main river channel. The river Mississippi has such a delta. Rivers are a vital component of our planet. The great civilizations of man have been cradled in their fertile valleys, like the Nile in Egypt, the Indus in the Indian subcontinent, the Tigris and the Euphrates in the Middle East, and the Huang He River in China. Even today, some of the greatest cities are situated on rivers. The rivers provide important routes for transportation. In India, rivers are worshipped, and the Ganges is one of the most holy rivers. Rivers provide us with water for drinking, and in agriculture, water is an essential input for food production, for our growing human population. Water stored in vast reservoirs called dams provides us with pollution-free, cheap electricity which lights our homes and runs our industries. Earlier in the film, we compared the development of a river in terms of a human lifespan, youth, maturity, and old age. Similarly, the rivers are like the arteries and blood vessels of our planet that carry the precious life-giving fluid water in an unending process of the hydrological cycle and thus ensure the continuity of life on our planet.